Now let's devote some attention to life insurance. Earlier I said that the life insurance that you own is included in your estate. We need to talk about what ownership means, so let me restate the rule in a different way. If you're the insured under a life insurance policy and you have an incident of ownership over that policy, then at the time of your death, the death benefit payable under the policy will be included in your estate for estate tax purposes. First of all, of course, if you're the outright owner of a life insurance policy that insures your life, the death benefit will be included in your estate for estate tax purposes, and it may be subject to the estate tax if the value of your estate exceeds the estate tax exemption. Even if you're not the outright owner of the policy, you're going to be considered the owner of the policy if you have the right to name or change the beneficiary under the policy, or if you have the right to surrender or cancel the policy and receive the cash value, then you'll be considered the owner. If you have the right to transfer ownership of the policy, you'll be considered the owner. Or if you have the power to pledge the policy for a loan, you'll be considered the owner of the policy. Or the power to borrow against it, or even the right to convert a term policy to a whole life policy. These are all incidents of ownership. In estate planning, we need to pay attention to those rules because you might have those powers in an indirect way. Maybe you control a company that owns the policy, or a partnership that owns the policy, or maybe you're a trustee of a trust that owns the policy. We need to find out whether you have such incidents of ownership through those types of positions. Let's start with some common will scenarios, and let's begin by looking at a simple husband and wife situation. This slide depicts a simple will, and let's assume it's one that would apply after 2018. In other words, in this case, the husband has an estate of $3,900,000, and his will does a simple thing. It says, "I give everything to my wife," so that after his death, she'll receive everything, and her estate will be $3,900,000, and then, after her death, the children will receive everything. This is a very simple will. Lots of people refer to this as the I love you will, but because of the tax implications of this, maybe it's less than a complete I love you, because there may be a tax cost to doing it this way. Let's look at what's happening here. The husband gives everything to the wife. Now, the first rule that I want you to keep in mind when it comes to estate planning is that transfers between spouses, when the receiving spouse is a U.S. citizen, are not subject to estate tax. That's the result of a thing called the marital deduction. So when the husband dies and his will says that his wife gets the full $3,900,000, if the wife is a U.S. citizen, there will be no estate tax on that transfer. No federal estate tax, and no Connecticut estate tax. But look what happens. In that case, the surviving wife's estate is $3,900,000. Keep in mind that the federal estate tax exemption in 2019 is more than $11 million. So when the wife dies, because her estate is less than the federal exemption, there will be no federal estate tax. On the other hand, keep in mind that the Connecticut estate tax exemption is $3,600,000. So when the wife dies, if the Connecticut exemption is $3,600,000, that means her estate would exceed the exemption by $300,000. The tax on that would be about $23,000. That's the way the taxes would work with respect to this simple will plan. Also, keep in mind that if this couple is worried about nursing home costs, there is no protection built into this plan to protect any of the assets from any types of claims, including nursing home costs. So think about the fact that when the husband passes away and the wife receives everything, she ends up with $3,900,000. Then, if she becomes frail and unable to take care of herself, and if long-term care is necessary, whether in a nursing home or at home, the fact that she has $3,900,000 will disqualify her from getting any state assistance to pay for the costs of long-term care. You might say that this is a wealthy person. With $3,900,000, the surviving spouse should use her own wealth to pay for her own care, and that's a valid point. On the other hand, especially with the elderly clients, we feel obliged to talk to them about, instead of giving everything to the surviving spouse, perhaps preparing a will that puts some of the assets in a type of trust that will protect the assets from claims related to such costs. The protection, however, would apply against all types of creditor claims. If the surviving spouse got into trouble with creditors, it would be the type of trust that creditors could not get access to. Or, if the surviving spouse needs to go into a nursing home, then the trust could be drafted so that the assets of the trust would not be counted as available to the surviving spouse for purposes of qualification for Medicaid or Title 19 benefits. This slide is about a different type of will. It's very close to the simple will that we've just talked about, and it once again offers no asset protection when it comes to protection against the claims of creditors or protecting assets from the cost of long-term care. But it does involve or include an opportunity to save some taxes. We call this type of will a disclaimer will. In this case, the husband who has $3.9 million has a will that once again gives everything to his surviving spouse. As we talked about before, if everything does pass to the surviving spouse, then there'd be no tax, assuming the surviving spouse is a U.S. citizen. In this situation, though, the husband's will includes a tax planning option for the wife to exercise shortly after the husband passes away. What happens here is that the husband's will says everything goes to the wife, but then the wife looks at the situation and says, "I appreciate the fact that my husband's left everything to me, but if I receive everything, my estate will be $3.9 million. That's more than my estate tax exemption, and that means when I die, there will be an estate tax to pay. So I don't want my estate to be more than the estate tax exemption. I'm going to reject the inheritance that my husband is giving to me, and I disclaim an amount equal to my husband's Connecticut estate tax exemption." The surviving spouse could choose to disclaim any amount. It doesn't have to be the exemption amount that she disclaims, but if she disclaims more than that, then there will be a tax on the amount that she disclaimed. As long as the disclaimed property is less than the available exemption, there will be no tax resulting from the disclaimer. So she can disclaim up to $3.6 million without generating a tax, and that's what this picture tries to illustrate. In this case, she says, "I disclaim $3.6 million, and the disclaimed property then moves over to a trust." We talked about trusts a little bit earlier. In this case, the trust could be prepared in a number of different ways, but we like to draft them so that the surviving spouse will receive all the income on the $3.6 million for the rest of her life. And typically, it's not unusual that the wife can have the power to withdraw up to 5% of the trust assets every year. So that's what she would have an absolute right to. She could also be a co-trustee of the trust, and then, at her death, the trust property passes to the children. In addition, like I said before, the surviving spouse would be entitled to all the income from the trust and would be entitled to withdraw 5%. If she needs more, then she's got to ask her trustee for it, and it's her trustee's job to evaluate that request and make sure it's consistent with the terms of the trust. So in this case, the wife disclaims the $3.6 million, and it goes into what we call the disclaimer trust. Everything else will pass outright to the surviving spouse. When the surviving spouse passes away, her estate will be small at $300,000, well below her estate tax exemption that we expect would apply at her death. So at her death, all the surviving spouse's $300,000 passes to the children tax-free. The disclaimer trust has been sheltered from tax by the husband's exemption of $3.6 million. So when the $3.6 million that has been disclaimed passes to the disclaimer trust, there's no tax on that because the husband's exemption covered it, and now the assets are in the trust. It's a type of trust that, even though the wife is the beneficiary, it will not be included in her estate when she passes away later on. So that will also pass to the children tax-free. As a result, the children end up with a total of $3.9 million without reduction for any taxes.